92.1 WROI, WROIFM.com. Streaming audio live, RTC Channel 5, audio and video soon to be on RTC Channel 4. Scott Sager, star of the show, welcome back.
Hey, you still got my coffee mug?
I do.
Okay.
Got your name all over it.
Been a while.
Yeah, nothing in it. It's empty.
Okay.
And that means on this Wednesday morning, time now for our Woodlawn Hospital Report. Chief Financial Officer John Kraft joins us. Hey, John.
Good morning.
Nice to have you back with us.
Glad to be here.
Well, that's good. And, of course, you have a special guest with you today.
I do. I have Paula McKinney, who is our new Vice President of Patient Services. Wanted to have her give a little intro of herself and give her a little bit of background on what she's been doing up to now.
That'd be great. We'll talk with Paula here in just a second. Folks may still not be familiar with John Kraft, the CFO.
Yeah, the last time I was on, I gave the work info, but I did not give the family info, and I kind of heard about that. But I have a wife of 33 and a half years who's probably the saint of my life because she's had to put up with me for 33 and a half years. We've got three kids. They're all grown and out of the house, spread out to the four corners of the United States. One is up in the western suburbs of Chicago. Matt, my oldest son, and his wife, Andrea. Brian, my next oldest son, is out in San Francisco. And then my youngest daughter, Katie, and her husband, Aaron, of about a year now, are out in Phoenix. So they're all spread out.
Good places to visit.
They are. It makes for a good vacation.
I'll bet.
We've already done that route from San Francisco to Phoenix once, and it's pretty special route.
Good.
But we have one addition to the family now. As of 3 months ago, Marie and I are grandparents. My son Matt.
Congratulations.
And Andrea. Thank you very much. And that's kind of special for being a grandparent for the first time. So wanted to have Paula give a little bit of an intro for herself.
Okay.
Good morning.
Hi, Paula. Nice to have you with us.
Thank you. It's good to be here. So I'm Paula McKinney, and I'm originally from Baltimore, Maryland, but I've been in Indiana about since 1989. I've been married 37 years to my husband, Reed. I have two adult children. They're twins, a boy and a girl. Going to be 27 this September on 9/11. And my son, Adam, is serving in the United States Air Force, and he's stationed in Okinawa, Japan. And my daughter, Kate, is a mental health clinician who specializes in art therapy, and she lives and works over in Lafayette, Indiana. So,
well, we thank your son for his service.
Well, thank you very much.
Very definitely.
I'm sure he would appreciate hearing that.
You bet.
So, I have been a registered nurse for over 30 years and went to school in South Carolina. And then once I moved up here to Indiana, worked at a few hospitals, worked at one hospital here in Indiana for about 15 years, and then moved on to learn and grow and develop programs and further my education and my learning. I've been in executive leadership now for about 12 years. So this is my third chief nursing officer job at Woodlawn. Came here in September. I replaced Cheryl Musselman, who retired after many, many years of dedicated service. So I had some pretty big shoes to fill, that's for sure. Since September, I worked with Cheryl until she retired in December, and then took the reins over from there. So we got a great team of people providing excellent care to the patients of Rochester. And so I'm just hoping to fill her big shoes and do a great job. So,
now, had you lived in Rochester prior to this position?
I'm actually still living down around the Kokomo area.
Got it.
So I've got about a 40-45 minute drive to work. Would love to find a small little place around the lake. That would be perfect, but it's just me and my husband now.
Sure.
So I don't need anything big, and what's out there right now is all these big places. So.
Right.
But yeah, that would be great to wake up and see that beautiful lake every morning.
Excellent. Well, it's nice to have you here.
Thank you.
And I'm going to go ahead, if I may, John, and just ask another question, because you're Vice President of Patient Services. What does that entail?
Well, that entails all of the departments that touch patient care. So not only just nursing, even though I'm a registered nurse and the chief nursing officer, the other departments that provide care to our patients, such as laboratory, cardiopulmonary, pharmacy, respiratory, any of those entities, all the diagnostic imaging, those areas report up through me as well. Also, education for the hospital and quality for the hospital report to me also.
Must be kind of an interesting position, because what I've noticed in talking with John and the other John is that the technology in terms of hospitals and hospitalization is changing all the time, changing very rapidly.
It is. Healthcare, as long as I've been in it, has been an entity that's changed. I always joke around and say, I don't understand why people don't like change and work in healthcare, because it changes all the time. We've got either new equipment or new medications or new treatments, new doctors, new people that you work with. So it is changing very much so. You know, several years ago when the electronic medical record hit, that was a major change in healthcare, because we did everything by writing. You know, we hand wrote everything. And when that change occurred, it was a drastic change for our industry, because a lot of other things changed along with that.
Do we still keep written records?
Sometimes we do. Okay. There are some areas where we have to keep paper charts, but then those records are scanned into the computer and become part of that patient's chart.
Interesting. We do the Doc Talk radio program from Woodlawn on fourth Monday of the month, and Dr. Seward was in this past Monday. Mm-hmm. And just in talking with him and the technology that goes into changes in hospital care and how we treat the patients, it's just amazing how fast things seem to shift from one to another.
It is. It definitely is. Dr. Seward is a great OBGYN doctor, does a wonderful job for our patients. But, you know, along with the electronic medical record, and I was saying so other things change, so like medication administration. Now we have these big old vending machines, so to say, and then that information connects to the medical record. So our documentation is seamless between two different entities. So that's something. So
let's flip back to John Kraft for a minute, Chief Financial Officer. You were at the board meeting yesterday.
I was.
All right. Anything to report from the Board of Trustees at Woodlawn Hospital?
Board of Trustees meeting yesterday had their annual audit presentation. BKD is the audit firm that does our audit presentation, and a little bit longer presentation than we had last year. I think last year we only had about 10 to 15 minutes, and I think they wanted to beef that up a little bit. So we spent a good 45 minutes talking about the audit, all the things that went into the audit, changes that are occurring, and we had Mr. Ranstad was there. He was the only commissioner that was there, but I think everybody is very comfortable with where we stand financially for the hospital for the year.
So is this all a financial audit?
It is.
Okay.
It is. Every 3 years, Paula gets her time with HFAB, and I get mine every year about this time for the audit. So this one was completely financial, but had a little bit of an overall profit, not much, but a little bit. Yep. And we're going to try to improve upon that over the next year. We've made a lot of changes to improve upon that. She was mentioning some of the technology changes. Wanted to get back. We put the new mammogram into place.
Yes, we did.
And we wanted to know that everybody know that for March, we budgeted 92 procedures. We actually had 174. Mm-hmm. For a while there, we were having some wait times as we were trying to get used to the equipment and getting the processes down. And we were doing about one an hour.
Yep.
And now we're doing about two an hour. And hopefully we'll get to three an hour by the time we're done. So
it's state of the art.
It is state of the
art. Yes, it is. I mean,
it is just the latest in mammograms.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Absolutely is. Absolutely is. So we're going to try and continue to improve upon the financial position. And as we do that, we'll be able to bring more and more new technology into the hospital, which is pretty nice for a hospital our size. So
exactly. Well, I mean, you know, even hospitals have to stay up and stay on the cutting edge and know what's going on and take care of the patients, basically.
Absolutely.
I do want to say that if there's any women out there that are needing their mammogram, come to Woodlawn and get that done. We've remodeled the area down there, so we have like what we're calling our women's area, so that you can get your mammogram, your DEXA scan, and any ultrasounds all in the same area. We've updated our waiting room area. So we're doing really great with that.
Excellent.
So our new mammogram machine, we received our FDA accreditation for that, and we're waiting for our American College of Radiology accreditation. That should be coming anytime. So we're up and running, so come get your mammogram.
All right. Good idea. Other notes from the Board of Trustees meeting, John?
Other notes from the Board of Trustees meeting, pretty much most of it was the audit presentation.
Okay.
We had the financials for the month. We had revenues of $11.2 million. We had contractuals of about $7.1 million, which is roughly that same 60% that we're usually dealing with on a monthly basis. Expenses of $4.3 million, and we had a small loss of $115,000 for the month. But overall, our revenues were down pretty drastically, about $2.5 million in March. It was a slow month. Everybody had spring break, and doctors were off too. So it was a pretty slow month.
But you budget for that in the beginning of the year. I mean, you take a look at that. Comes down the line, right?
We do. Right. As John says, and by the way, it did take two of us to replace him for this month. But
yes, but we won't tell him.
We won't tell him that. usually 80% of our income comes from outpatient ancillary care, and that usually comes from the physician offices. And as people get active, as you get more into the summertime, then they'll start getting out, and stuff will start happening with
that. Do you take a look at the financials on quarters? So can you so far in 2019, up, down?
Revenues have been down roughly about, patient days have been down about 20%. Revenue's probably down about 8 to 10% right now. We've done a pretty good job of flexing with the expenses, so that our loss is only $125,000 from operations, and we still actually have a net profit. Remember, we have the nursing home program that comes into place, and we're trying to create a profit from that, because you never know when that nursing home program may go away. With government reacting the way they react these days, with health care, we're kind of waiting to see what shoe's going to drop next on us.
Does that make you both nervous in terms of federal government primarily, but state government perhaps, in terms of what they're going to do with health care? Because health care is a big issue. They talk about it all the time.
They do. That's why, Paul, I mentioned that we have to change almost on a weekly basis. Sometimes it seems like it's on a daily basis. But, like I've said before, we kind of hold our breath until the government comes out, and then we have to react to it.
Right.
So we make adjustments just like anybody else does. Everybody else has to react to the winds of the government programs and stuff. So we do the same thing. We're pretty nimble.
Both of you have been in healthcare for a long time, so this is maybe a silly question, but are there any easy answers to the whole healthcare issue and the finances and that type of thing?
It's getting harder and harder. The number of independent critical access hospitals is dwindling drastically. The sad case that's going on in the United States is that in other states, and we have had one in Indiana that has closed, but in other states, they're closing right and left. So it's becoming more and more of a challenge to do that. And that's why we probably have to be even more nimble than we were even a couple of years ago. So I think new ideas is something that I think John wanted to bring in when he brought both of us in. So new ideas, new types of thinking, and just trying to stay ahead of the curve is what we're trying to do.
Paula, what do you think?
I agree. You know, I think over the years we've seen the government put lots of restrictions on hospitals. So from the RAC audits that started back in the 90s that continue today, changes in how reimbursement is done. So it is getting more and more, sad to see how critical access hospitals are in danger. But I think our board of trustees is so engaged, and we've got a great CEO, that they're going to keep us independent and keep us operational. So I'm not worried about this position. I plan to be here until I retire. So, but we do need to comply with those federal and state regulations, and we do what we can.
Yep.
Is it even possible to plan 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the road?
Yeah, it's kind of funny, because strategic planning used to be 3 to 5 years down the road. And as John has said more than once, it's hard to plan even 1 or 2 years nowadays, because the assumptions that you make today may go away in the next 3, 6, 9 months, and then you have to scrap it and do it again. Although you have to have some type of a pathway to go down to try and overcome all the changes that are occurring. So there may not be a formalized plan yet, but we'll probably.
Our plan this year is the Rural Health Center. So that's
Rural Health.
We get that
clinics
up and going. That's our strategy this year.
Yeah,
and that is
we've got two programs that are going on. Two huge programs that are going on right now. There are some programs that the federal government allows for the rural health care and for critical access hospitals. As you know, we're cost reimbursed instead of under the prospective payment system. Rural health clinics is where the physician offices are actually going to be cost reimbursed. So they'll do pretty much the same thing that they do with a hospital. They'll figure out what the cost is on the cost report every year, and then they'll pay prospectively what that encounter cost is going to be, which is much more than what the physician fee schedule, which is the way they're currently being paid right now. That's one program.
Okay.
And then 340B program is another one where we have the advantage of with provider-based providers, with hospital-based providers, we're able to get government pricing, 340B pricing, for outpatient drugs that are scripted by the docs for both patients in their program, and then also for some of the outpatient services, ED and oncology in the hospital. And that pricing is a pretty good savings for us.
I know that we have Compassionate Care Clinic here in Rochester, and I know a lot of folks use that. I'm curious as to numbers of people that come to the hospital under the Affordable Care Act. Do you find more people with insurance now?
It has taken off, but it hasn't taken off as much as everybody thought it would. I know that everybody was preparing to have, I mean, when they had the Affordable Care Act, the number was always thrown out there, 35 million uninsured. Now, that did come down, but it did not completely go away. So it hasn't taken off as much as the authors of the bill probably thought it would. But it has helped quite a bit. It has helped.
Interesting to know, too, that the people seeking services probably, compassionate health care probably keeps a few folks out of your ER, right?
I would think so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's always a challenge is the most expensive place to take care of somebody is in the emergency room. So anything that we can do to take them back to the physician office and have it taken care of there rather than in the ER is going to help us. So we're always constantly looking at ways to try and keep them in the physician's office.
Yeah, it's that preventative care. So going to compassionate care and having their immunizations done or getting their physical done, getting some lab work drawn, changing medications, that is what helps them stay out of the ER.
We have the new mammography machine. Any other plans for additional new equipment or work to Woodlawn Hospital?
We have plans for our Neoncoden central patient monitoring system that will be put into place within the next couple months. That's been approved by the board.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So it's just a matter of doing the final purchase for that. So that should be put into place. And there are other projects that we couldn't bring this month because we had the audit presentation taking all the time.
But exactly.
We will have in the next couple months.
John Kraft is Chief Financial Officer for Woodlawn Hospital. Paula McKinney, Vice President of Patient Services. What else would you like to pass along to the listeners and viewers today?
A couple of items. We have our CBO, Central Business Office, is doing some updates. So they wanted to let everybody know that they will never ask for payment by email. We know that there have been some scams out there in which people have been asked for payment by email and that Woodlawn Hospital will never do that by email. We are also expanding some of the customer services that we have in the CBO so that people may be dealing with somebody a little bit different because we're rearranging the alphabetical process that we're utilizing to split out the accounts. The CBO has a new main phone number now. It's 574-223-BILL or 2455. So
good way to remember.
Hopefully that makes it a little bit easier for people to call into that central number, and then hopefully it'll be a little bit easier to get to the correct person for that. We have new statements coming out, so for all self-pay amounts, All the amounts for the hospital and for the physician offices will be combined into one statement. We're hoping that'll make it a little bit easier. We do have some glitches that are going on, so we're telling patients, call into that new number and talk to their billing contact if they have any questions. We are not going to send anybody to collections, so people are finding out that they may have bills that they haven't gotten a statement on for a little while, so we're telling them, be patient, we should have that worked out in the next month or so. And then we also have, in the physician offices, we have, everybody talks about using an iPad or something to check in. We have now put that into place with a firm called Freesia. We have iPads in each of the clinics so that it'll help people to get registered. They can, instead of waiting for that front desk to become available, they can grab one of the iPads and go through the information themselves and check that off. You can make a copay payment while you're waiting. You can do a lot of stuff with the iPad. It's also available through a website too. So a couple of days beforehand, people will get an email or something that will let them know that that Freesia is available for them. And phase two, there will be some clinical involvement where some wellness information will be gathered, but that'll take a little bit while. We've only been on it for 9 days right now, so it is brand new. And then one last thing, OB wanted to make an announcement. Their next prenatal class is May 18th at 9:00 a.m. And if there are any questions, they can call the OB department at 574-224-1250. I guess that makes us legal now, right?
I guess it does. That's right. As we wrap this up, Paula, the flu ban has been lifted, right?
It has, okay. Yes. We enacted flu precautions because in Indiana we saw an increase in the band of people that were testing positive for influenza A. So we put those restrictions in place to protect our patients. So the ban has gone down. There is less flu going around through Indiana, and so we've lifted those restrictions last week.
Flu season over?
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. We should probably still see it through maybe till the beginning of May.
Too late for a flu shot?
Too late for a flu shot.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. John Crafts, Chief Financial Officer, Woodlawn Hospital, and Paula McKinney, Vice President of Patient Services. Thanks very much for being here today. Thanks very much for sharing. And thanks very much for keeping our area very healthy. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.